Owen thinks that if there was no Church of England, cucumbers wouldn't grow.
If the globe has undergone such profound changes in its history, geologically, surely all living creatures must have changed with it to adapt to their new conditions. Otherwise, they would have perished.
Some did perish, it seems.
Yes, but the continued existence of life on Earth can only be explained by the assumption that a creature like this was replaced by the modern-day armadillo. There must be a law which causes new species to appear in place of the extinct ones.
That, my boy, is the mystery of mysteries. The person who can solve that riddle will take all of the scientific prizes.
It's the variety of their beaks that's so amazing. They graduate perfectly in size. From this large parrot-like beak, similar to a hawfinch, perfectly designed for cracking nuts, to this tiny warbler finch, fine as a chaffinch, to feed on insects.
And they're all descended from this one, the common ground finch.
I've started to prepare some colour plates.
Now put my words to shame. Raz! Raz? Oh. Raz! Wake up!
What time is it?
Lunchtime.
Oh. Well, then go away and come back at tea time.
The Galapagos Islands are almost identical. The same geology, the same climate.
I'm glad to hear it. Now go away.
So why should different finches inhabit identical islands? Raz? Small changes over ages and ages can throw up mountain ranges and sink continents. If mountains can move and rivers can move, and why can't animals? Finches, tortoises, iguanas. If you trace animals across the surface of the Earth, or dig down and trace them back through time, you come face to face with the same truth.
Which is?
New beings can appear on the Earth. Perhaps everything is part of one ancestral chain. Man, mouse, armadillo. No. It's nonsense to think of animals or man as climbing some ladder. To talk of one animal being higher than another? No. No. I think it's more like a tree. A tree of life. Each new species springs from the parent tree like a shoot. These shoots branch and divide in their turn, and so on and so on. Some branches die out, others keep developing. The trunk, the ancient common ancestor. The stock from which all animals and plants sprang.
Nursed by warm sunbeams in primeval caves, organic life began beneath the waves. Hence, without parent, by spontaneous birth, rise the first steps of animated Earth. Grandfather Zoonomia. Would it be too bold to imagine that all warm-blooded animals have arisen from one living filament? It's in our blood, Charles.
Grandfather was vilified for it.
It's in our blood.
What Charles Darwin glimpsed over 150 years ago is now the bedrock of biology. All forms of life on Earth have evolved on a single branching tree of life.
One of the most important ideas that Darwin had was that all living things on Earth were related. How can you realize that you are part of this single tree of life and not be fundamentally moved by that? It's something that stirs the soul.
Following in Darwin's path, biologist Chris Schneider and his colleagues have come to South America, to a remote region of Ecuador near the base of the Andes Mountains. The rainforest may be home to more species of animals than anywhere else on Earth. Darwin had been awestruck by its endless variety of life. He wrote that he felt like a blind man being given sight, and that the sounds of the rainforest were like a great cathedral at evensong. For biologists today, the lowland rainforest and the nearby Andes Mountains are laboratories for exploring Darwin's ideas.
Shut up. Did he bite you?
Over the next several days, Schneider's team will track down rats and frogs, bats, birds, and lizards, through day and night, both here in the rainforest and high up in the mountains. By comparing the two groups of animals, they hope to better understand how changing environments might trigger the evolution of new species.
You just can't help but be awestruck by the fact that there are so many different kinds of things here. There are 12 species of primates. There are 550 species of birds that have been identified here. There are 100 species of frogs. Right here, in this little area.
Wow, that's great. The Spicelinus.
Why is there such diversity here?
We've got plenty of stuff.
Oh, we got some good stuff. We got a mind blower or two.
Yeah. Let me show you this one.
Ornithologist Tom Smith wants to compare the size of birds' beaks from the rainforest with those he hopes to find in the mountains. Even subtle differences may offer clues about how and why new species arise. Just as it was the beaks of finches from the nearby Galapagos Islands that spurred Darwin's thinking in the 1830s. Darwin saw that the finches he brought back had uniquely shaped beaks, adapted to the different foods on the islands. He envisioned that these different species of finch had all descended, with modifications, from a common ancestral population that had flown over from the mainland. Darwin's bold insight was to apply this vision to all of life, to see that the great variety of life on Earth, leopards and lichens, minnows and whales, flowering plants and flatworms, apes and human beings, all descended from one root, one common ancestor.
It was indeed another one of his radical proposals, not only to say that evolution happened, but that there was a root of common ancestry to everything that lived on this planet, including us. You could construe it in other ways that is, I like to say, are more user-friendly. You could have thought, well, God had several independent lineages, and they were all moving in certain preordained directions, which pleased his sense of how uniform and harmonious world ought to be put together. And Darwin says, no, it's just history all coming with descent with modification from a single common ancestry.
The key to Darwin's thought in every realm is that given enough time and innumerable small events, anything can take place by the laws of nature. So whether it's the raising of mountains or the evolution of new species, all of these things happen through time and change.
The rainforest holds striking examples.
Take a look at this mantis here. This thing is almost perfectly disguised as a leaf. I mean, but you can see, if you look at the underside, that it's a praying mantis, just like you'd find in a garden in North America. But this one is highly modified. Its thorax is flattened out to look like a leaf, and its wings are modified to look like leaves. You can even see the veins. If you imagined a population of mantises and some looked more like leaves than others, those ones that look like leaves may tend to survive and reproduce more than others. And so a series of modifications could build up over time to result in an almost perfectly leaf-like mantis. But if you put it on a background, you know, on which it doesn't belong, I mean, it just sticks out like a sore thumb, and it would almost certainly, where are you going there, pal? It would almost certainly get eaten by something.
Before heading into the mountains, Smith collects more birds to add to what he's learned in the rainforest.
Lower bill length.
How different will the Highland birds prove to be?
9.2. Coleman is 10.
Different enough to be considered new species?
Exposed Coleman.
Branching off in a new direction on the tree of life?
When the Andes were uplifted, it created a whole variety of new habitats. The animals that were in the lowland rainforest had an enormous opportunity to colonize these new habitats, and they did so. The real question is whether adaptation to these new environments can lead to the formation of new species.
Flying less than 1 hour, Schneider and Smith move from the steamy lowlands to the windswept Andean peaks. Animal populations made the same journey, but gradually, over many generations. And as the environment changed from rainforest to the high, cool grasslands, animal populations were forced to adapt. These grasslands lie nearly 2 miles above sea level. Seasons never change here, so close to the equator. But it is said that winter visits every night. Temperatures often drop below freezing. Animals not well adapted will not survive.
Hummingbirds are amazing. It turns out that they can drop their body temperature 50 degrees and go into a state of hibernation to withstand the frigid nights here. You can imagine a small-billed hummingbird living in cloud forests some thousand meters downslope from us. And if those individuals were to expand their range up into this habitat, where perhaps flowers are much longer, you could expect that individuals with slightly longer bills might survive better. And in fact, there are many examples in hummingbirds where we know that small changes in bill length can make important differences in how that bird extracts nectar and how well it survives. We're seeing that changes in the environment can be very important in changing the characteristics of those animals as they move between environments. And we believe very strongly that, in many cases anyway, that this can be very important in the progression to new species.
From one species of bird, the common ancestor, hummingbirds with beaks of different lengths evolve over many generations. And if these populations